Soon you will be alumni. I know now you're students, but very soon, soon and very soon, as the song goes, you will be alumni. And if you can't take it any other way, as Dr. Hendricks used to say, take it by faith. Okay? You can make it. You can make it to the end. You can be alumni. You can be Dallas Seminary alumni. Well, what about placement? That is finding a full-time vocational Christian ministry position. Could be where you're raising your own support, could be where you're paid by someone, but generally speaking, could be bivocational also, but generally speaking, a full-time vocational Christian ministry position is what we're talking about. Now, I'm going to have three categories here, so I want to gauge kind of where you're at. You don't have to vote yet. Don't raise your hand yet. Raise your hand when I tell you to, but the first category is going to be, you know exactly where you're going, okay? You have this locked down. You know exactly where you're headed. You've already talked about compensation packages. You know you're going to be full-time, etc. That's category one. Category two is you've got a couple of leads. You maybe have a few directions you're headed toward. You know some people you're going to talk to, but you're not quite sure exactly where you're headed or what you're going to do, but you've got some ideas. And then category three is I have no idea where I'm going. Okay, I have no idea where I'm headed. I am like Abraham who went out not knowing where he was going. Okay, so let's vote now. Over here, you know exactly where you're going. You have this totally locked down, and there is no one. Okay, that's good. they're already locked down, so they're not here. Now, how many of you are in the middle? You have a few ideas. You kind of have some leads. Okay, good. And then how many of you are over here? You have no idea where you're going. Okay, good. Yes, Dr. Ash. So that's good because that's what I want to know. I want to know, do you know where you're going to? The first thing you want to do, write this down. The first thing you want to do is pray. Okay, we take that very seriously. You want to pray. You might even build a prayer team. You want to elicit people to pray for you. You want to let people know that you're praying. I spoke in chapel last week, and I talked about how this looking for a position like that is not mysterious. We don't use pagan practices. We don't believe you can look ahead and divine God's will. We think you can look back and see God's will reflected in your life, but we don't believe you can look forward and mysteriously determine God's will, like finding your next job by listening to a Christian radio station or something, or saying a prayer, and then the first thing that pops into your mind after you pray. Those are pagan practices. We don't believe in that. But we do believe there are ways you can take to network, to build a great resume, to show people what you're good at. And all of that is a part of placement. So the first thing is pray. One of the next things is you have to really learn to be yourself. Okay, so you could write that down as be myself or be who you is. It's just being your most authentic self, being your most true self. Now, we have some people watching online. We have some people watching at the extension sites. So I'm so glad. I like to travel to some of the extension sites when I can, but there are some people that couldn't be here today. There's some people at extension sites that are watching. So think about this and reflect with me. Who are you at your most core? Who are you in your most natural gifting? What is it that is your passion, okay? And you really need to start with that, because it doesn't take long before you start seeing some of these openings and you say, wow, that's what I want to do. I want to do that because it's in Florida. And then you start to realize, you know, I'm not really being true to myself. I want to do that position. I want to apply for that position. I want to interview for that position, really because it's in Florida. And we've had real live stories from people to look back and say, you know, I wish I would have waited, or I wish I would have taken a different position, because I kind of got nervous, I got desperate, I got scared, and I just took this position even though it really wasn't who I am. Well, you need to be true to who you are. Find out, ask other people, reflect, journal, find out really who you are. Now, what we talk about is once you really find out who you are, what you're passionate about, you want to try to find a position where you're doing that like 80% of the time, okay? There's no position where you get to do what you really want to do 100% of the time. Very seldom does that happen. So when you see these positions, sometimes they'll have different types of openings. You'll be spending 80% of your time on missions, and you go, yeah, that's what I really want to do. And then you'll be spending 20% of your time on budgeting and helping with facilities. And you're like, well, I don't know if I really want to do that, but if I can get a position where 80% of the time I'm doing what I'm really passionate about, you should strongly consider that. You should really pray about that. So sometime in life, you have the get-tos. Do you know what the get-tos are? How many of you have ever been to summer camp? Anybody ever been to summer camp? No one in this group has ever been to summer camp? Okay, several of you. The get-tos are, hey, you get to go to sleep by 11. You get to clean out your room. You get to help clean up after dinner. Okay, those are the get-tos. And in a lot of these ministry positions, you'll get some of these. And that might not be what you're passionate about. It might be, I'm on hospital visitation. I help with weddings. I help with funerals. And you think, that's not what I'm really good at. But then you realize, I'll be teaching every Sunday, or I'll be training teachers every Wednesday night and Sunday morning. So sometimes in these ministry positions, you think, God, you must not be leading me to that, because surely I can't be over parking. I hate parking. But you might be doing 70, 80% of the thing you really love, and yes, you also will be over parking. I had someone recently that said, I'm going to be a children's pastor. And then the person that was with him said, man, you hate children. So we had to keep digging. You know, I was like, wait, is this true? Well, yeah, I don't really like children. Why are you going to be a children's pastor? Because there's a really good opening, and I think I'm just going to take it. I've been offered the position. I had another person in my office that told me they felt like the Lord was calling them to Maui. That's okay, but what has to happen? There has to be an opening in Maui, okay? We have to get the planets to line up. You want to go to Maui, there has to be an opening in Maui, and it has to be the type of position you want, and they have to want you. So a lot of things have to happen for you to get to Maui. We don't just dial up a job in our office and go, oh, good, you'll be going to Memphis. So let us dig into this. How many of you brought a laptop, a phablet? How many of you brought an Apple Watch? What you want to do is dial up, if you can, placement, dts.edu, and I think you'll go to the alumni tab, and you'll be able to do this online. If you're watching from home, take out your laptop right now. Go to the alumni tab, dts.edu, click on the alumni tab, because that's what you'll be. And then under alumni, you'll see placement. Did you see that? Am I going too fast for anybody? Right under alumni, you can click on placement. And the placement office is here to help. We have 4 full-time people in our office. Myself, Kevin Hawkins, Jerry Lawrence, Beth Jasper, a current student. So you can call our office. You can set up appointments with us. We do a lot of Skype interviews, Skype appointments. And we want to meet with you and hear your story. We want to hear what's God doing in your life. We want to partner with that. We're not going to just put a job on top of you. We want you to tell us, what are you dreaming about? What are you passionate about? What are your future goals? And then we're going to coach you. We're going to look at your resume. We're going to circle it, draw lines through it. We're going to talk about interviewing. We're going to talk about compensation packages. We're going to talk about parsonages. We're going to talk about candidating. So underneath, you'll go to 4 graduates, and then you can apply for placement. Now, everybody in this room should apply for placement. Why is that? It's free. Good reason. For the first 12 months after you graduate, it's free. After that, there's a small charge, $35. But for the first year, it's free. So even if you were to tell me, hey, I'm pretty sure where I know where I'm going, you should apply just to see some of the different openings we have on here. And here's another reason. I've said this before. We've had people that have come in and said, hey, I'm good. Don't worry. I know where I'm going. Thanks for your help, but I'm good to go. And then 3 years later, guess what happens? They get that phone call from the elders and say, well, that pastor that promised you that position, yeah, he no longer works here. And that director of women's ministry that said she was going to hire you full-time as her assistant, yeah, she went to a different church, so you'll have to check with her now. Or, hey, this is the head elder. I've been tasked with calling you, and giving is down. When you left here and you were going to go to Dallas Seminary and come right back, giving was up here. And now giving is down, and we're not going to be able to do that anymore. So sorry about that. And that's all, under the lordship of the direction of God. God knows all about that, and God's going to lead and guide in His perfect way. But sometimes plans break down. That's what I'm trying to say. Plans break down. I had someone in my office just the other day, and every other line he kept saying, well, my plan was to go back to my home church. I said, oh, yeah, that's all right. Let's just keep going here. And we'd talk for a while, and then he'd go, you know, my plan was to go back to my home church. And then we talked about his resume, and then for like the fourth time, he said, you know, my plan was to go back to my home church. I felt like, well, man, forget the plan. Okay, that didn't work. Forget's in the past. You're not going back to your home church. I got that. Let's just drop that. You know, I felt for him because his whole mindset was just, this is not working out. I was going to go back to my home church. I'm like, hey, welcome to the great adventure. Welcome to walking with Christ. It's going to be an amazing ride. God's going to take you places you never dreamed of. You know? So, don't let that meme get in your mind. Don't let that mindset get in there where you're like, well, I have to go to this type of church or I have to do this position. Be open and willing to what God may do in your life. So getting started, you'll just fill out this placement application. And you're a graduate, so it says graduates begin here. And you'll fill out this form. It'll tell you what part of the country are you willing to receive offers from? The Northeast? How many of you would say, sure, Lord, I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll go to the Northeast. Thanks, we have one. I'll go to the Midwest. I'll go anywhere in the world. There's another category of going anywhere in the world. We have categories like rural, urban, suburban. So you get to pick a lot of those categories. Then we get into denominations. Wow, we have a lot of denominations. So you click those boxes. Which denominations are you willing to have your resume be sent to? Which denominations are you willing to hear from? So you get, it's like match.com, okay? I want to go out with tall, dark, handsome, and then the other person says, yeah, I want to be with tall, dark, handsome. Bing, you get an email. Your resume has been sent to the following church, okay? So you get to pick a lot of that. Now, if I can hack into this system, if it'll let me, I'm going to show you what it looks like in the ministry opportunity listing. Yes, I'm going to do it in front of you. Let's see if I can make it work. Go to the alumni tab. You go to the ministry opportunity listing. And these are being changed all the time. I approved a couple this morning. Okay, so as these get filled up, as people take these positions, poof, they go away. But then new ones are coming in. And the beauty of this system is these ministries are specifically asking for Dallas Seminary graduates. That's your win, see? They're not asking for just, this is not ministersearch.com where anybody in America is sending up their resume. These ministries, because of our 91-year reputation, these ministries are specifically asking for Dallas Seminary graduates. That's one of the best parts. Now, we have these code words. And we don't mind using other websites. There's nothing wrong with using other church ministry websites. We recommend some of those. But ours is specifically locked down for you guys. You're not to show this to your friends from other seminaries. You're not to show your classmates from other Christian colleges or Bible colleges. So let us look at this. Search for ministry positions. And I'm just going to... Here, let me show you some of the... See, AP stands for associate pastor. So look at that. You could say evangelism, singles, missions, media. You could do one of those. Look at the geographical areas, the states. Yes, I'll go to Delaware. Yes, I'll go to Mississippi. Yes, I'll go to the Sub-Saharan Africa. Look at the denominations. Yes, I'll go to some of these denominations. Now you look at one of those and you go, wait, I'm not going there. All of these in the past have... ask for Dallas Seminary graduates. It could be a summer camp. It could be a clinic. It could be a curriculum writer. So you might see something on here and go, whoa, what's the deal with that? They might have asked us for a part-time worker, a full-time worker. And then you see they're rural, small town, suburban, urban. So you'll go in and what we urge you to do first is start narrow. Start with your dream. Start with, hey, I really would like to do this. But if it's been 6 months, then what? Let's broaden the circle, okay? The circle of trust. Let's broaden that a little bit. See, I'm watching you guys. Let's broaden that. If it's been 9 months, what should you do? Really broaden it, okay? Hey, Lord, I give up. I'm willing to go wherever you want me to go, Lord. And if it's been a year, what should you do? You should change occupations, okay? That is not true. We believe God is sharpening you. He's honing you. Now, look at some of these. What you're going to get is, this first category here says associate pastor. Look at that. So, connection director. See, the days of just like, there used to be four categories. Pastor, Christian ed director, worship leader, and youth pastor. And that was kind of it. Well, today you'll see all kinds of stuff. Look, the first two that pop up are connection director and discipleship director. Community development. Now, over here you get the size of the church. All three of these happen to be right around 700. San Antonio, is that the same church? Yeah. So a big church down in San Antonio looking for two different openings. Don't write these down, okay? These are confidential. Waco, Texas, the E-Free Church in Waco, Texas. Let's scroll down and see a few more. Here's the place. Switzerland. Who wants to go to Switzerland? Thank you. I see that hand. Okay. Buses are waiting. Okay. Well, Austin, Texas. Who wants to go to Princeton, New Jersey? Okay. Think about your audience at Princeton, New Jersey. Okay. Educated, not educated. What do you think? Probably pretty educated. Probably master's degrees, maybe. What we call white collar professionals. Maybe you don't want to go there. Maybe you want to go to small town, Kansas, Oklahoma, Missouri. Those are two different types of ministries, and you need to think through that with us and pray about that. Here's Dallas, Texas, Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship. Look at how big they are, 10,000 people. Okay, another important thing to think about. Do I want to go to a small church of 100, 150 people? Do I want to go to a big church of more than 10,000 people? Everybody in here is different. Some of you want to go to a big church. Some of you don't. You need to think through that. Now, once you get into this title right here with the underline, what does the underline mean? It's a link, so you're able to click on it. So here is a missions pastor. Now, we've had some misconceptions about that. People say, I don't want to live overseas. Does a missions pastor live overseas? Not necessarily. Oftentimes, a missions pastor sends people overseas, and they investigate a lot of the different missions agencies, but they might live right there in the Woodlands and take trips, probably take 3 or 4 trips a year overseas. So someone says, I hate traveling. Okay, you hate to travel. What are you interviewing for? Missions pastor. Yeah, you'll probably take 4 or 5 trips a year cross-culturally. So we click on there, and then that gives us a lot of the data. Look, I'm going to be talking to Kenton Sanders. Here's the email. I'm going to be sending a resume. Full job description. Should you ever take a position without a job description? No. Always find out, hey, can I get a copy of the job description? What if somebody says, well, we don't have a job description? What? Well, let's talk about that. You know, why don't they have a job description? Here, you just do the work of the Lord. So you really want to get clear on that, because later on it gets messy. I thought you were in charge of the youth. That wasn't in my job description. We never gave you a job description. See, a lot of confusion. Is this a new position or a previously existing position? Why is this position open? Our former missions pastor felt God's leading to take a position in another church. How many are in the junior high, the high school? When was this church started? 1979. Gender preference, E, which means what? Eunuch? No. Either. They're saying, hey, it can be a male or female. Married? They prefer married, it looks like. Sometimes it'll say either or single or married. Now, when you get down here, you get into salary. A lot of times, they'll either put a salary range, or they'll put something like that, depending on experience. Housing benefits, stuff like that. So there you go. You're going to be able to log in here. If you apply for placement, you can log in here and you can see all of these openings. And you can start to apply for different ones. Look at all the, see where my cursor is over there on the far right? Look at that. I'm just getting warmed up here, people. Now, sometimes we have ethnicities on here, and someone would say, why is that? Well, they've sometimes requested that. If this is a traditional African-American church, you need to know some of the traditions, some of the cultural ins and outs. If you don't, the interview may not go well. So they may either prefer an African-American graduate, they may prefer an Asian graduate. Recently, I spoke at a church in California, Sacramento, California, beautiful area. They had three services. Grace Chinese Bible Church in Sacramento. They had the English service, they had the Mandarin service, they had the Cantonese service. I spoke in the English service. Okay? They may ask you that. Do you know Mandarin? Do you know Cantonese? Do you know Spanish? If you know English and Spanish right now, you're in a great advantage. A lot of churches are starting Spanish services. So if you know some other languages, don't be shy about that. Say, I know Mandarin, I know Cantonese, I know Spanish, I know German, I know French. Don't be shy about that. Now, let's say you the church says African American and you're Anglo and you want to work there. Well, you go ahead and apply and just talk to them and say, hey, I feel a real burden. I want to work at a multi-ethnic church. I prefer, our office is really excited about that. We want to see more multi-ethnic church staffs. So, amen. I mean, we need to be the church. So let's push those barriers. We're encouraging our people, interview all types of people. But there are some Asian differences you need to know about. There's some African-American differences you need to know about. We don't want you to go in there and flunk the interview and look really bad. In some Asian churches, you have to have a lot of respect for elders. And so you need to know that. You could step on a landmine and not get even a second interview. I had an Asian student in my office the other day. He said, You almost have to have white hair to be the senior pastor in an Asian church. What did he mean by that? You have to have a lot of experience, a lot of respect. You might be the most gifted person in the room. You might be the smartest person in the room, but you need to wait your turn. You need to show respect. So if you don't know that and you go in and flunk some of that, you probably won't get a second interview. You won't get a phone interview or a call back. So one of the things I want to do, I know we have Q&A, and that's oftentimes the best way to do this. But let's go up here. We're going to do Q&A, but these are some of the different categories. See, so you can click on, I want to be a chaplain. I want to go into counseling. I want to go into media ministry. And if you don't see an opening here, we want to partner with you and help you. We want to make phone calls on your behalf. We want to beat the bushes and help you find a position. Big categories are full-time paid, and then raising your own support. Okay, that's a whole other world. Nothing wrong with raising your own support, but you need to know that ahead of time. Maybe bivocational as well. Still a lot of bivocational. And so you can feel free to check in on that and ask them, is this a full-time paid position? Or will I be asked to raise some of my own support? And that needs to be cleared up on the front end, because you don't want to get into three or four interviews and then look back and go, I never knew I was supposed to raise my own support. No one told me that. Some of you are good at that, and some of you would say, I don't want to raise my own support. But don't let that be the sole determinant, because oftentimes people find out they can raise their own support, and it's a wonderful position. A lot of the nonprofits, you'll be raising some of your own support. Justice ministries, community outreach ministries, and we have openings in that. Now, who has got some questions? I could talk for like 3 hours. But I would rather have you guys ask questions. Resume questions, interview questions, compensation questions, how to apply for certain church questions. Be thinking about those, okay? We got one here, let's go here.
Yeah, so when do we actually start this process in terms of going online?
Good question. You can do this up to 12 months before you graduate. Now, why is that? Huh? It's free, but there's another reason. It can be a long process. We had someone a couple years ago, they walked across the stage at Prestonwood, they shook hands with Dr. Bailey, and then they came into our office the next day and said, okay, I'm ready for my position. And we were like, whoa, you should have been here like 9 months ago. It's like delivering a baby. This takes 9 months. There are phone interviews, Skype interviews, on-site interviews, search committees. You see where I'm going here? Potluck dinners.
How long is that process?
Our average right now is about 8 or 9 months.
8 or 9 months.
Yeah, that's our average. So some are shorter than that, but some can be longer than that. So do this now. Start. I know you're full-time with writing exegeticals and papers. I know that. I've been there and done that. But you also need to say, every Monday morning, I'm going to do a little bit of this. Every Friday afternoon, I'm going to do a little bit of this. I've got guys right now that have their Excel spreadsheet, and they've got about 7 or 8 ministries they're talking to. And that's how you have to do it. You have to have a yellow legal pad. You have to have an Excel spreadsheet. Why? Because it doesn't take long before this gets really complicated. Am I talking to Phil from Philadelphia? Or am I talking to Barbara from Baltimore? It's like, whoa, hello? Is this Fellowship Bible Church? Oh, community, yeah, that's right. Community Bible Church, yeah. Oh, that's right, yeah, yeah. That doesn't come across so great, right? I remember my wife is a neonatal nurse practitioner, and I would be at home with our kids. We've been blessed with 5 kids, and they would be in the other room. I said, kids, Dad's trying to get a job, okay? Be quiet, be quiet. I'd close the door. Yes, I'm ready for my interview. Guess what happens next? All 5 kids fighting, yelling, screaming, laughing. And the people on the phone are like, are you having a problem there, Paul? No, I'm a man who can control my household well. I'm having no problems with my children. You guys better shut up. Next question. I also remember my wife being a neonatal nurse practitioner. When she went in for different interviews, she was like, they never asked for you to come to my interviews. What did she mean by that?
They want.
She was like, how come I'm going on your interviews? They may ask for that. They may say, hey, tell us about how you grew. They'll break all the HR rules, okay? Know that right now. Many of these ministries will break all the HR rules. Yeah, we'd like to talk to your wife. We talked to one church one time, and they looked at her and they said, are you ready to disciple the high school girls? She was like, I'm a nurse. And they're like, well, the last associate pastor, his wife, what? She discipled all the high school girls. Be ready for that. Question over here.
Yes, sir. Do the churches know what your interest level is that you click on?
No, that's for our office. Thank you. Good question. This is what? High, medium, low, and never. This is remove, okay? And this helps our office. Our counselors, our placement counselors look over these, and when they start to see a pattern, they're like, okay, this person, remove. They don't want to stay in Texas. I get the drift here. They're definitely not. They want to get out. So it helps us if you guys go in and click these. Thanks. Good question. Up here on the top. When you're 12 months away from graduation, so if you're May of 16, you should be in now. If you're May of 17, come around in like May or June and jump in.
Related to those two questions, the system, as a current student, wants you to go through CampusNet, and then it pops up and it says, you can't do
it. Oh, you're not ready yet.
So how does the system know that we're able to do this? Is it based on application for graduation? Is it based on
Hours, how many hours you've completed in your degree program?
And so then my own question was, I noticed there were age ranges there.
Uh-huh, yeah, that happens a lot.
Over 50, how soon do I have to graduate before nobody wants me?
that would be, did I just tell you that some of these churches will break HR rules? Do we have that on tape? You'll see it right there. People will say, we want to hire somebody between 35 and 40. You're like, what? Age discrimination, height discrimination, you'll get all kinds. Now, sometimes if it's a youth pastor, they may want someone younger, you know? How many of you have done lock-ins? That gets hard. That's, you know, when you're 60 years old and you're doing lock-ins, that gets old. But sometimes they want older person, pastor of care, pastor of shepherding, pastor of, you know, taking people to Branson, Missouri. I mean, they want, so it just depends. It is harder. If you're 65, it's very, very difficult to get a ministry position. even like 63? Why is that? They think, oh, she's going to come here for 2 years and then she's going to retire. No thanks. We'd rather hire someone who's 48 or 38. So yeah, they will put right on there ages sometimes. And it can be helpful. Now, if you feel led to contact them anyway, you just should bust through that barrier and just chat with them. Go, hey, I just need to let you know, this is my hometown, or I love this church. I know you put 50 on there. Like myself, I'm 51. So I'd fight through that. You know, I'd go, hey, I'm 51. I'd love to talk to you guys. I feel like I'm 30, you know. I would love to interview for this position, and let them tell you no. You know, if they go, hey, you're 51, what, you know, let's have a cup of coffee. So don't let it totally scare you. Now, if it says 30, you know, and I'm like, I feel 30, that they're going to go, you're 51, dude.
So you mentioned one thing we'll do with you guys is have an interview. You'll give us some counseling with our resume.
Yeah.
And it seems like it's going to be an ongoing process, but you're like with us kind of most mm-hmm. of the day there. What do our meetings with you guys look like? So in the very beginning, how long, you know, are we going to be talking with one another before we actually start engaging with someone?
Your first meeting with us might be 45 minutes. We might go get lunch. And we want to hear where you're from, what your goals are, what your gifts are. We want to look over your resume. So that initial one is just kind of, who are you? What's your plan? What are you looking for? And then following up, a lot of people come in for advice. Like, hey, I'm talking to two churches at the same time. You know what that's like? That's like trying to date two persons at the same time. Or two people have asked you to prom. So people say, hey, I'm talking to this church and it's going good, but I'm a little worried about compensation. They haven't brought up the topic yet. Should I bring it up? So people will set up brief appointments or phone interviews. So the first interview would be lunch or 45 minutes. But then after that, we can just ask and answer specific questions. Or if it's been like 6 months, 9 months, and you're getting nothing, like you're getting no interviews, you're getting no traction, we'd like go back and start over. Let's start this whole thing over. Let's look at your resume again. There's three piles that we want to look at, okay? This first pile is resumes. You're going to be sending out a lot of resumes. Get that in your head right now, a lot of resumes. There's nothing wrong with that. When I was in placement, okay, these were paper. You remember that? Had to be a certain kind of paper. You bought it over at the bookstore. It's like a Monopoly, really. It was expensive, you know, and you would send it out. You'd make a mistake, throw it away, 100% cotton paper. Now almost all the resumes are digital. You're emailing them out, or they might be on your own website. So you're going to send out a lot of resumes. Next pile, a little bit smaller, you're going to have some interviews. Okay? Big stack of resumes leads to a handful of interviews. And then the third pile is offers. You're going to get a very few number of offers. Some of you in here maybe only get one or two offers. An offer is a very big deal. If a ministry is offering you a position, you need to take that very seriously. They may be raising extra funds to bring you on board. They may be replacing a very good ministerial person. So if someone offers you a position, you don't need to go, hey, thanks, I'll consider that. You know, hey, I'm probably moving on, but hey, thanks for offering. You need to be very serious. Wow, I'm honored that you would offer me a position. You know, my spouse and I, we're humbled that you guys are offering us a position. Could we have a week? Could we have 10 days to pray about this and finalize this? So what's over here in this huge stack? All together now?
Resumes.
Lots of resumes. What's here in the middle?
Interviews.
A few interviews. Skype, in person, phone call, a few interviews. And then what's over here?
Offers.
So that's how we're going to work your plan. If you're not getting any offers, what are we going to look at?
Resumes.
Not yet.
Interviews.
What's going wrong in the interview? Are you arguing with people? You know, do you have bad breath? What's going on here? If you're not getting any interviews, what are we going to look at?
Resumes.
Because if you have a fairly good resume and you've been through this school, which has a very good reputation, 91 years, you should get some interviews. So if you're not getting any interviews, we're going to look at your resume. So that's the plan we're going to look at. Yeah, we've got templates of resumes. It's a little bit different than a marketplace or secular resume. Sometimes marketplace resumes are one page. Oftentimes ministry resumes can be three pages. You could have a picture of yourself on there. So Let's see if I can make this work. Is this one already loaded up? So what happens when you put too many buttons at once? You got the border on there. Maybe you got a, I mean, who wouldn't hire this family? Come on, look. Husband, wife, two little boys. And we have this picture that you can use in our office. No. Obviously, all the data on there, very important that everything's current and up to date. We have sometimes people that have left from this place and they're using this address, St. Joseph Street, room number 209, whatever. Guess what happens? You're long gone, and they're still getting resumes that say Swiss Avenue. And I call later and I go, didn't you talk to Kevin? What happened? Yeah, he never wrote back. He never called us back. What do you mean? Who'd you call? Oh, we called Washington Hall. Well, he left Washington Hall 6 months ago. You guys get the hint. Everything has to be very up to date. Emails, you want that to be very professional. We had a guy a year ago or so that was like, phil@bestpreacherever.com. You know, that doesn't look that great. Or studmuffinkevin@ bigbicepsbill@yahoo.com. Probably not. That was like your college email. So just come in, look at some of these templates, look at ways of formatting these. It doesn't have to be just like this, but a nice template. References all need to be very current and up to date. We had somebody, I'm giving you worst case scenarios so you can avoid them. Hey, is this Dr. Johnson? Yeah, you remember Steve? Vaguely. So that's not good. You need to call your references like every month or so. I want to bring you up to date on what I've got. Two churches I'm talking with. I've got a ministry I'm talking with. We're moving. You want to keep your references very up to date. When was the last time you talked to your references? And did you get permission to put them on there? We've had some professors here that were like, they never asked me to be a reference. You guys know all that stuff. But those need to be very current, very up to date. Good questions. Also, the references need to be a variety. We've had some people that used four DTS profs. Okay, mix it up a little bit. A friend, an acquaintance from home, someone you've worked with, someone who's been a supervisor in the past. Mix those up. Three or four different types of references. Okay, other hands going up? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And on the second half of that question, what about applying for a job where
you're not quite qualified? Mm-hmm. Yeah. With the experience, don't forget that everything you've done counts as experience. We've had some people mistakenly say, well, that wasn't a full-time church job. Doesn't matter. If you volunteered with Young Life, if you helped put on a vacation Bible school, all those things you've done, you need to start thinking in those terms. And talk about transferable skills as well. Let's say you were in a marketplace position. Did you ever work with budgets? Did you ever raise up volunteers? Did you ever hire someone? Did you ever conduct a staff meeting? All that stuff's very important. So when they say that, you need to say, well, I do need to let you know for 3 years I was in charge of this. Or for two. Don't ever backtrack. Don't ever apologize. Don't ever go, well, you're right. I guess I should leave now. You always think in terms of, just share with them what you have done. Now, I hear what you're saying. Some churches would not hire the Apostle Paul, okay? So if that's the case, you just need to realize, I'm not going to get this position. It's just not working out. They want someone who's been a senior pastor for 12 years, and I've never done that. So, but don't, have your interview skills ready where you have some good answers, some good strong answers. You know, for my last 2 years of seminary, I was a chaplain at Union Gospel Mission in downtown Dallas. And let me tell you some of the things I did. Okay, one summer I went to Kenya, Africa with Campus Crusade for Christ. Let me tell you what that was like. Have a couple of stories ready where someone could change their opinion of you, where someone could hear that and go, wow, I'm going to give this guy a second chance. I'm going to call this guy back. At the end of the day, if it's just you against someone who's way more qualified than you, that's in the Lord's hands. But try to do all you can. And the second part of your question, I want to make sure I answered that right. The first part was not enough experience. What was the second part of his question? Okay. Yeah, just that's a part of being yourself and being who you are. Talk about transferable skills. Talk about your gifting. Talk about how you're ready and willing to join this team. You want to be very humble when you're in these interviews. I talk to pastors and they say, sometimes a Dallas Seminary graduate comes in and they act like, hey, I'm here to help. When do I start? You guys are going to be amazed by how good I am. Kind of like Donald Trump, you know. This church is going to do so much winning. It's going to be huge. That doesn't come across that great. The interview, the search committee is like, yeah, probably not. So much better to come in with an attitude of humility. I'm here to help. I would love to serve on this church staff. I see what God is doing at this church. Here's my gifts. You know, could I partner with you guys in what God's doing at this church? Don't come in like, let me tell you how much knowledge I have now. Come in with an attitude of rolling up your sleeves and working at the church, serving, helping. That's a much better approach to take. Other questions? Yes.
What role is LinkedIn?
Okay, good question. It's very dangerous, okay? If you have a Facebook page and it's got some questionable material on it, you need to be very cautious. Churches and search committees are looking at that stuff. And you're like, well, it was just a party. I was just there. I wasn't the one that was wasted or on the floor. Well, it's on your Facebook page and it looks very awkward. Your LinkedIn, it can be very professional, but it just needs to be kind of neat and tidy. So people are looking at that stuff. You can use that if you think it's helpful. Some of you have sermons or teaching, and if it's good, you know, you can use that. Here's a recent example of myself teaching a class. If it's good, use that. If it's not good, don't use it, okay? It can be brief, and you might pay someone to edit it down. It would be worth $25, $35 to say, hey, I know you know how to use video. Could you boil this down to kind of the best of? Just give me like 7 or 8 minutes of good teaching. That's what people want. They just want a sample. You know, that's what you would do if you were on the search committee. You'd just fast forward it, wouldn't you? You'd fast forward it and you go, I just want to get a feel for this person's teaching style. I want to get a feel for her presentation style. So you would fast forward it and you'd just watch a few minutes. Well, why not take control of that and get someone here from Media Arts and Worship and say, hey, can I give you $35, $40 to help me put together a good teaching video? I want to put it on YouTube or Vimeo.
Two questions. First question, on all the job opportunities, is there a way to sort that by experience you're looking for if someone doesn't have much experience? Another question is, what resources do you have in your office other than what we see in the
phone? Good questions. I don't believe we have the ability to sort just by experience. We do location and job title and gender. I don't believe we have experience, so we'd have to go through and look for that. And in our office, we have compensation books on how much you should get paid, surveys from national groups. We have four of us, so there's four full-time people. We have Greg Hatteberg, who's the director of alumni, who was director of placement for 12 years. He has a wealth of experience. We have networking abilities with other graduate Christian schools and seminaries and lots of churches. So I think we have a really strong office of resources available to you to help you. Good question. Yes?
As students are thinking about kind of course selection and emphasis selection, mm-hmm. how often, because a lot of these people are looking for how often do those types of conversations come into play as students are looking at these?
A lot of questions revolve around internship. So be thinking about that. Have you ever helped with a wedding? Have you ever helped with a funeral? Have you ever made a hospital visit? If your answer to all those questions is no, they might go with a different candidate who's done a lot of that. They don't often say, did you ever take introduction to... They don't oftentimes get in real specific, but they do want to know what was your degree and what was your emphasis. And you want to be very honest about that. If you just took one class on Jonathan Edwards, you don't need to come across as a Jonathan Edwards expert. You know, Go ahead, ask me any question about Jonathan Edwards. I had one elective on Jonathan Edwards, but you could share that. You know, I love church history. I did quite a bit of classes on the early church. So you can share what you've studied and what you've learned, but it's oftentimes that practical experience.
How often does ordination come into conversation? You are or not?
Ordination, very hot topic. Licensing is one part of that. Ordination is another part. Ordination is a denomination or a church setting you apart for the work of ministry. It's a group that says, we've tested this person, we've tried this person, and we're ready to put our imprimatur on him or her. So when you get ordained, it's oftentimes in a specific church or a specific part of a denomination, and that's a big decision. Say you get ordained in a Southern Baptist church. Well, then later you may want to work in a Methodist church or a Presbyterian church. They may ask you about that. Hey, we see you're ordained Southern Baptist. How strong is that affiliation? Are you only willing to go to a Southern Baptist church? Or the other way around, say you're ordained Methodist or Presbyterian. Oftentimes people are ordained in a Bible church or an independent church, and that kind of serves several ways. But you want to do that. Generally, it's your first or second year in ministry. Oftentimes they won't ask for that ahead of time. Well, if you're not ordained, we're not going to hire you. Oftentimes they'll say, you know, we're going to help you with that. So if you're younger and you've never been ordained, you will often get involved in that. Now, I was on an ordination committee a couple years ago with Dr. Jeff Bingham. That was tough. Some of you are too young to remember Bingham. That's like the nation that knew not Pharaoh. But Bingham is an expert in church history. He's an expert in doctrine. He's a wonderful, godly man. But he was very tough on his ordination. But afterwards, when I was leaving, I felt like, you know, that student, they get to leave with like a Jeff Bingham patch. You know, it was like, they left, and I felt like they could interview anywhere in the country and do fine. So if the church just says, well, we take you in a room and we pray and then that's it, that's not that big of a deal. You want to think through, I really do want to be asked about what I believe. I really do want to be ordained by a healthy group. Oftentimes people will ask you later, where were you ordained or who was on your committee or what did that involve? Stonebriar has a nice ordination process. They'll take 5 or 6 candidates. It's like a one-year process. They meet like every 2 or 3 weeks. They study, they learn, and at the end, it's like a group of overseers who sit in on that interview. And you have to be ready to answer those questions. I mean, it's important to know what we believe, right? So, good question. But some churches will say we require that ahead of time, but often it's you'll be ordained the first or second year during your ministry. But it's important who you're ordained by. That will go with you kind of your whole life. Yes? Ah, yeah, good question. Oftentimes, if it's a smaller school or if it doesn't have a huge reputation, a master's could be enough. So a master's of theology is still a very healthy degree. If it's a bigger school, a bigger city, or a great reputation, nowadays they need you to have started on a PhD at least. So the days of just going out with a master's and saying, okay, I'm ready to teach at Moody or Wheaton, those days are pretty much over. Believe it or not, pretty much all Bible colleges and Christian colleges now in the U.S. want you to be starting on a PhD. Now, you don't have to have it totally completed yet. You could be what's called ABD, all but dissertation, or you could say I'm a PhD candidate. But now that is not true overseas, cross-culturally. If you want to go to another country, they would love to have you come and teach. Some of the Bible colleges, Christian colleges in other countries, they would love to have a Master of Theology. And we have a lot of openings for that. So kind of in the U.S., probably you need to be praying and dreaming about a PhD. Other countries, maybe going over there and getting started and then working on a PhD later. Oh, yeah. Christian high schools are very popular. And those jobs oftentimes don't come open very often. Someone works there 15, 20 years. So the best way is to be flexible. Would you be willing to teach another class that maybe isn't your favorite? Would you be able to do some coaching? Would you be able to be one of, you know, some of the supervisor roles? I'm in charge of the yearbook. I'm in charge of teaching students how to get their driver's license. So you really have to be flexible on the front end. And then after you've served a few years and built some credibility. So you might start in something like the DISD. The DISD right down the street, Ross Avenue. Teach in Dallas for a year or two. And then when you go out and interview at Christian schools, you have a much better opportunity. They'll say, have you ever taught? Have you ever taught in a class? And you say, no, not yet. That's not as strong as, yeah, actually, I'm teaching right now. I'm teaching in the Dallas Independent School District. That's what we call coming from a position of strength. Yeah, I'm teaching now. I'm teaching currently. Every school district is different. I'm on the school board at my kids' school in Rockwall, Heritage Christian Academy in Rockwall. And so we work with the ACSI, the Association of Christian Schools International. Go to their website, ACSI, the Association of Christian Schools International. They have topics on accreditation. They have topics on certification. They have topics on openings around the country. So every school district is different. In Dallas ISD, they will help you get certified. They will help you get that certification. They are wanting teachers. I saw a billboard recently. It says, want to teach? And then below it, it says, when can you start? What does that mean? They're looking for teachers. And we've had people here teach in DISD for a year or two, teach in Richardson, teach in Garland. Then after a year or two, you're certified. They've helped pay for your certification. You have one or two years of experience teaching. Now you're really a much more marketable candidate. You got time for maybe one more?
Some of us in the MACL program, mm-hmm.
A lot of parachurch, still a lot of church staff, but oftentimes not the senior pastor. Some missions. So, you know, everybody needs leadership. All organizations need help with leadership. So I would use that as your strength. I want to help set direction. I want to help set vision. I want to help recruit and train people. But just come in and talk to us, and we'll look over some different openings. The problem is it's kind of a newer degree, so our alumni out there are still learning about it. I know for these folks that have been doing it for 4 or 5 years, it's not new. But you think of people who are out there who are alumni, they came here 15, 20 years ago. And they want to look back and say, oh, do they have my degree that I had when I was there?